All right, hi. I'm Eric Ries. I write a blog called Startup Lessons Learned, and I'm one of the founders of this lean startup movement. Been an entrepreneur for about 10 years. My most recent company was called IMVU, 3D avatar, social networking site, instant messaging site, and really excited to be here.
So, what is the simplest way to explain lean startup? Is it the words, build, measure, learn?
Yes, yeah, that's true. Let me try to do it. I'll give you the very quick elevator pitch and see if this makes any sense. The first question is, if you're an entrepreneur, how do you know you're making progress? Right? So if you're building something that fundamentally nobody wants, what does it matter if you're on schedule, you're on budget, you have, the features are polished or not polished? At the end of the day, your success as an entrepreneur depends on having a product or a service that resonates with a core set of customers. And so we say that the unit of progress in a lean startup is this thing we call validated learning about customers, which means everything we do needs to be measured about how well are we learning what customers are going to want, rather than how well are we writing code or doing our like specific function or job. Okay? That's an important first step because when we take ideas from the lean manufacturing revolution, the first principle of lean is learn to tell the difference between value-creating activities and wasteful activities. And in a factory, that's complicated enough where we're trying to figure out, are the parts of a car valuable or is only the car valuable? But in a startup situation, it's even worse. Not only do we have to have this issue about are the parts valuable, is the car valuable, we have this even bigger question: do customers actually want a car? Or actually, are we building an airplane? Or actually, is it a lawnmower? Or actually, is it a rocket ship? Right? We're not even sure who the customer is, what their needs are, what they define as quality, what the problem we're trying to solve for them. And so it really requires a shift in mindset from value is building stuff to value is learning about customers. And that's where this concept you mentioned, this feedback loop, build, measure, learn, comes in. Because the second key insight from lean manufacturing is once you've learned to tell the difference between value and waste, and you've purged the like obviously wasteful things out of your process, so we're going to stop building stuff, way in advance of having any evidence that customers want it, but going to get that evidence sooner. Second key idea is now let's focus on the cycle time, the feedback loop between when we have an idea and when we've managed to create value out of that idea, which in the context of a lean startup means the time between when you have an idea and then you've validated and had some learning about whether that idea made sense or not. So that feedback loop is three stages. We build the product, we turn ideas into code or into some kind of product form, we show that to customers, which creates data, we measure. And then, if we want to, we can choose to learn from that data influencing our next set of ideas. And the time through that total feedback loop is really the essence of a lean startup.
So, is it fair to say that Lean Startup is a methodol is actually a methodology to get traction for your startup?
Yes.
And in this loop where you're pushing ideas, is the idea in your formulation the actual product idea, or is there a smaller quantum that is an idea?
It's both larger and smaller, because the problem with I think the true curse of being an entrepreneur is that no matter how visionary you are, getting like 8 out of 10 things right is failure. In order for a startup to be successful, we have to not only build a product, but it has to be a product that solves a real problem for some customers. There has to be enough of those customers to sustain some kind of business model. The problem has to be important enough for them that they're willing to invest time, money, passion, or skill in getting that problem. You have to have the ability to reach those customers through some form of distribution. The pricing has to work out to be profitable relative to your costs. And of course, you have to actually have the technical chops required to do the actual whatever invention or innovation you're trying to do in the product. I can keep going, enumerating all those things. Think about it. You get every single thing right. Great problem, great product. But for whatever reason, it's in a business where no one finds out about it. Doesn't matter. That's still failure. So the goal of the lean startup is to validate every aspect of the founder's vision, through kind of rigorous and scientific testing rather than through faith-based assumptions. And also, at the core of all of those things I just mentioned is the fundamental product hypothesis that the founder holds. And that fundamental hypothesis has to be right in order for the rest of the stuff to matter. So usually when we're validating pieces of the business model, the first thing we're going to choose is what we call the minimum viable product, which is just what is that smallest quanta of work that we can do that starts us on that learning feedback loop. But it's not necessarily the case that every kind of business you would want to validate the exact same kind of risk, you know, first, because in different businesses, the level of risk you're taking is different.
So day one, say you want to be a lean startup. I want to get to what exactly you should do. So is it that you should pick apart your idea into assumptions and then find the cheapest minimal way to validate those assumptions with actual customers?
Yes, I think that's a very good plan. Writing the assumptions down is a pretty important step because human beings are so good at instantaneous after-the-fact rationalization. So whatever happens is always what was supposed to happen somehow, you know, even if that makes no sense at all. So it's important to be clear about what the assumptions are. And then, yeah, you know, usually what we urge for Lean Startup is to do two things in parallel. We call it problem team, solution team, but separating out these two things. One is a set of people or a set of time in the company. Even if you're a single person, you can be on these two teams, right? Dedicated time for asking the question, what problem are we trying to solve? Who's the customer? Is this actually a good business to be in at all? You know, those kinds of questions. But in parallel with what we call the solution team, which is trying to build some version of the current hypothesis, whatever it is. The issue is that if you only do one thing or the other, you tend to go off the rails pretty fast. So if you're only thinking problem, what problem should I solve? And you're talking to customers, that's a very good thing to do. But if you're only asking customers, hey, what problem would you like solved? You know, pretty soon you'll be building teleportation or, you know, quantum computing or some kind of infinite longevity device, right? What do people really want? Well, they want free money and they want, you know, long life and they want happiness and all kinds of impossible things. If you have the technology to build those things, great. But if what your, you know, kind of your vision and your technical team is trying to create is divorced from those customer conversations, then you kind of get off into fantasy land. It's really important to find some way to get both of those pieces of the conversation happening at the same time.
So
on the flip side, just one more thing, it's important that you actually start building right away. Build something, not the world's biggest, best platform for X, but get started in realizing some aspect of the vision, because in the process of rendering it into reality, you often discover things about the vision you didn't realize. Plus, a lot of really great products that had great disruptive potential began life as simple toys. You know, Facebook didn't seem like it was going to be the most, you know, world-changing company when it first started. It was just an app where you could poke your friends on a college campus. If they had only been engaged in customer development at that point, just talking to people about would you like to poke your friends in the abstract, they never would have found out that actually people really do, because what people think they want and what they actually want is often quite different.
So you need to build a prototype, basically.
Yes.
And get that into the hands of potential customers.
Yes.
I've heard various things around, talked about ways to do that, like make landing pages and other tricks like that. Are those just all tools that you consider them, or are there any kind of standard practices that you think almost every startup should be doing right at the beginning to achieve this sort of assumption validation?
It has to be industry specific. So, you know, if you're building a software product that you plan to distribute over the internet, there are some pretty standard practices. The simplest one is just create a destination where customers can get whatever version of the product you have in development. I mean, whatever's in your sandbox. If you're developing something, there's some usable piece somewhere that some engineer has. Okay, that. Distribute that, not to as many people as possible. Don't go on TechCrunch, don't go pounding your chest about how brilliant you are, but come up with a mechanism for getting a consistent number of customers to be coming to that destination on a daily basis. Doesn't need to be a lot. You know, when we first started building IMVU, we did this thing we call SEM on $5 a day. Okay, so in those days, $5 could buy you 100 clicks on Google AdWords because 5 cents a click was the minimum you could bid for. And so we didn't know any better. We thought, okay, yeah, 100 people, that sounds like a lot. It's not much of a marketing campaign, but every single day we would spend our $5 and Google would bring us 100 human beings coming to our landing page and we'd offer them the chance to register, download our product and buy it. And we naively thought like half of them would buy it. And we were pretty stunned when zero of them did. You know, first day, zero buy, okay, that's cool, but we'll just wait for the next day. And you know, new batch comes tomorrow. And then second day, third day, fourth day, fifth, you know, 10th day, gosh, 1,000 people have been to our product and none of them have bought it yet. Like, okay, something's not right. And then that becomes a, that establishes a baseline. Look, 0% is not very good, but it's a start. Whatever the measurement or whatever the number is, even if it was 1%, even if it was 50%, then we at least have some baseline understanding of how customers respond to this product. And then that gave us a report card. Every single day, are we actually making the product better or not? Because what would happen is we'd like spend 3 months shipping all kinds of new features. And we would just assume, because we like those features, that they must be making the product better. But then you say, wait a minute, the same percentage of people, you know, of that 100 a day, you know, we got it up to like one a day we buy. After we made the product dramatically better over 3 months, it's still one a day buying. That's odd. How much better can it be if it hasn't changed customer behavior at all? And so that becomes like a reality check for your early product instincts. You know, are they right or not? And of course, we always talk like it's binary, but it isn't. Which of your instincts are right? Which of them are wrong, right? Wrapped up in your vision is probably some genius visionary stuff and some pretty crazy delusional stuff. And learning to tell the difference is actually quite hard.
So a lot of startups stay into stealth way too long, way basically. Too long. And there's so many great ways to get 100 visitors a day now. Pickfoo, yeah, Stumble Upon, Mechanical Turk. I mean, it's like Reddit. There's ridiculous ways to do it. So there's really no excuse, in your opinion, right?
I think that's right. And that's true whether you're building software or not. Because even if you're building the world's most complicated physical product that requires a chip fab and I don't know what else, you know, I'm just trying to imagine like the most difficult kind of product you could build, you could still be engaged in this kind of customer discovery exercise. You could still be bringing customers to whatever form of distribution you plan to eventually sell them the thing and get them engaged in that process of talking to you about it. Because remember that every startup has to begin necessarily with early adopters. You know, if you buy into the technology lifecycle adoption curve, early adopters adopt before the mainstream, and they are a distinctive kind of person. They're the kind of person who are interested in partial solutions. Mainstream customers want whole solutions. Early adopters love partial solutions. They like to make something their own, and they like, in general, being part of the creation of that solution with you. So if you can't find anybody who wants to be part of the conversation and wants to be part of the creation process for a product, that's a really bad sign that maybe there actually are not any early adopters for the thing you're trying to build.
So in terms of the methodology cycle time, yes. Would it be fair to say that if you were testing once a day and making a test once a day, your cycle time is once a day?
That's right. The biggest constraint in most organizations, I mean, there's artificial constraints like, well, we are on a 2-week release cycle, and so you can't release more than 2 weeks, which, you know that I advocate this thing called continuous deployment, where we put deployments into production 50 times a day, which basically on a continuous basis to get rid of those artificial dependencies. Once you get rid of that kind of technical stuff, get that out of the way, then the true constraint on your ability to iterate is simply your ability to learn. So the question is, how much information can your team actually process and make decisions based on? And if that's a test a day, fantastic. It might be a test every 3 days. It might be 3 tests a day. It depends on what kinds of things you're testing. In general, once you get to continuous deployment, I actually then recommend people kind of take a step back and don't test 50 things a day. That's impossible. You can't keep track of 50 things a day, right? Now start to think about what's the fewest number of big tests I can run that will really tell me the important stuff. So instead of testing like button colors and like minutia of optimizing conversion rates, we focus on what are the experiments that might have an unexpected result that would cause us to really re-examine our assumptions.
So basically things that would be first order effects, not second and third order effects. Things that would move your company, you know, not just move it an inch, move it a mile or something.
Yeah, and the curse of product development is sometimes big things make no difference and sometimes the tiniest thing makes a huge difference. So there isn't necessarily a correlation between how big the diffs are of the code and how impactful the thing is for customers. In fact, in a lot of cases, changing the language that you use to describe your product, thanks to the effects of positioning, can be, you know, cause dramatic changes in customer behavior, more dramatic than building a really complicated feature that basically they don't care about. So it's tricky. You got to stay focused on, you know, when we say test the big things, we mean test things with big impact. Not necessarily test big blocks of code.
Okay, so in preparation for this, I asked a bunch of people for questions, and I want to get to some of them. So bunch of people were wondering sort of what are, if any, sort of valid criticisms of this lean startup approach in your mind?
What are the valid criticisms? I
If
mean,
there are any.
yeah, this Eric Ries guy. Boy, what the hell is he? Why should we listen to him? Yeah, it's a pretty valid criticism. Valid criticisms. Well, I mean, Lean Startup is so new that most of the people who have even taken the time to have a position about it generally haven't taken the time to really understand what it's all about. So, like, there's currently a debate going on the internet about fat startups versus lean startups, which is really about how much money should be raised and when, what the money should be spent on, which is just basically, my point of view, an orthogonal issue to the issues that we're talking about. Lean startups are not cheap startups. The goal is not to spend as little money as possible, because if some of your costs are accelerating you through that feedback loop, then cutting those costs caused you to actually just go out of business slower, which that's not. Like, yeah, you cut costs, congratulations, you lowered your burn rate, but you didn't actually accelerate your pace of learning. So, you know, that's no good. And the flip side is, once you really get good at learning what your business really is, like what are the facts about who your customers are and the problem you can solve for them, then you have the ability to spend a lot more money a lot more effectively to scale that business up. So, you know, I think that set of criticisms is kind of misplaced. You know, what else to say? I mean, I think when people first hear about using split testing to make product decisions and kind of being data oriented, kind of in the boardroom, you know, not just you know, in the direct marketing team, they sometimes get confused to say, "Oh, this is basically linear optimization applied to your startup, and we can pretty much write a piece of software to make the decisions for us. Turn it into a spreadsheet. The spreadsheet tells us what to do. We just crank, turn the crank and follow the metrics, and boom, you know, we get to success." And that's really not. I think that's again a misunderstanding of the model. You know, we talk about this, the local maxima problem. That, you know, if you're just doing hill climbing, you can easily get stuck in a product that's like optimal for this particular set of customers, you know, and there's no like little itty bitty change that can get you know, any better. But there's a much better product you could be in, you know, just down the street. And so if you're really willing to have some courage and do this thing we call a pivot, you can pivot your whole business model to try something new. And Lean Startup explicitly tries to encourage people to take those risks. And just do it with facts in evidence about A, what's likely to work and not work. That's why we have the problem team, solution team framework, right? So that by the time you realize, when the solution team realizes we can't squeeze any more improvement out of this particular product iteration, problem team can say, you know, but we've been talking to customers and this isn't even really the right problem for them. Let's do a problem pivot where we keep the same set of customers, but try to solve a different, more important problem for them, keeping the technology more or less the same, right? So we reorient the business. That's what Lean Startup is all about. We just want to get those pivots to happen faster, and not waste as much time going from pivot to pivot by acknowledging that the vision is probably wrong in some ways, and we're going to discover which ways it is.
So, related question to this fat lean startup debate. There's other sort of mantras that people use in the startup, internet startup world. I'm wondering how they relate, if at all, to lean startups. So, the make something people want thing. Just comment on each, if you will.
Sure, yeah. It begs the question, what do people want and which people anyway? I mean, there's nothing wrong with that as a starting point, and I think compared to build something I think is cool, it's a huge step in the right direction. I mean, really. I think it limits people unnecessarily to products that they themselves are the customer for, which is not a bad rule of thumb. Like, when in doubt, you know, if you're not sure who the customer is, like, build something at least you have an opinion about. But it's pretty easy to delude yourself into thinking you know you are the customer when you're really not. I see a lot of young entrepreneurs get into that situation. And even if that gives you a good initial insight, it still doesn't tell you questions like, well, how many people like you are there in the world? And are they all like you in this specific way? How are you going to find them, reach them, right? There's still a lot of open questions that doesn't answer. And so, you know, and the fortunate ones who build something people want are then like, well, now what? Because, okay, now I got a bunch of customers. They're all telling me to do all these different things. How do I know which feedback to take and not take? So I think it's a good starting point, but integrated into a more systematic framework, it can be a lot more powerful.
What about release early, release often?
Yeah, again, you know, nothing intrinsically wrong with that, but that can't be the end of the story. Because as soon as you have two customers, you already have three opinions about what to do next. And I mean, you see that release early release often comes out of the open source community, and a lot of open source projects, you can see how this crazy schizophrenia where they actually get some success and have some customers, and now they're trying to like take in patches from like people who want to take it in different directions and still like be true to their vision. And the successful ones are the ones that combine release early release often with some kind of really strong visionary leadership who says, yeah, we release early in order to validate my vision, not just to do what people say. And so it's that combination of putting things out there, getting feedback, and using that like to inform your vision rather than to advocate for vision.
I got two more of these. Fail fast. You've heard that a lot recently.
Yeah. I like failing fast. And in fact, in Silicon Valley especially, we are not good at talking about failure. We like to do success theater instead, right? Make people think how successful we are instead of being honest about what worked and what didn't work. We have to be careful, though. Our goal is not for the company to fail fast. Our goal is for our ideas to fail fast and to separate out idea failure from company failure. And the idea of pivots is our ways to keep the cost of failure low so that we can then be more likely to succeed in the end. So what is it that's failing fast? It's our bad ideas. And then the speed with which we can show that an idea should fail or succeed becomes the key, you know, the key determinant of success.
Okay, what about the sort of side debate of, okay, you need to start a company with hacker founders or one hacker founder and one, you know, business founder, that kind of thing?
You know, there's evidence to support every combination as far as I can tell. I know it's like most of the people who I have heard weigh in on this subject are basically saying like, here's what worked for me and my friends. And I can't think of any examples of any counter examples, but the counter examples are plenty. You know, there are plenty of examples of companies where, you know, and if you go to business school, you hear these cases all the time. Well, there are like three MBAs get together and they say, we want to create a very profitable business. We're not sure what it should be and we have no special skills. Let's analyze our way into a cool business and then, you know, iterate our way to some kind of, you know, awesomeness. And that works for some people under some circumstances. So I just think these formulas are stupid.
So in terms of the lean startup though, you still need someone on the problem team, right? Does that lend itself to not being two hackers all the time, you know?
No, because both teams have to be cross-functional, which means somebody, even the problem team people need the ability to run experiments themselves. And so they need to have access to resources that can build things. So there should be engineers on the problem team, no matter what the composition of the overall company is. And the solution team needs to be guided by customer input and market awareness, even if all they're doing is like building infrastructure, because you know, the details of what customers consider to be acceptable matter a lot to the usability of the product, to the scalability of the product, what customer behavior is going to be. So there's a lot more cross-functional collaboration in a lean startup than in kind of the traditional model where we pretend that a startup is just a shrunken down big company and we're all in our little departments, you know, doing our thing. So it's important to have that kind of thinking represented on the team. But some of the best product managers and marketers I know started life as coders and are really intimately connected to what customers want. Some programmers are basically catalysts for taking customer ideas and translating them into code. That's what makes them so special. And there's some coders who are basically completely antisocial and only want to do their own thing and don't care what other people think. And so what job you have is not the key question. The question is, what's the mix of skills that you have on the team? Do you have the external, you know, outward-facing ability to go out into the world and test your ideas and get information and bring that back? And then do you have the ability to take that information, incorporate that into your vision, and then keep executing in whatever business that you're in?
Okay, I have some specific questions now. Mike Sabelski, who's at Other Inbox, asked this question. I've always wondered how continuous deployment, which is your sort of methodology of releasing code continuously, works when there are many commits per day. Does each change get its own deploy?
That's actually a really good question. The goal of continuous deployment is to work in the smallest possible batch size. but smallest possible batch size. So in an ideal world where commits took, where deployments took exactly zero time, and in which the reason it takes zero time is that you can instantaneously tell whether a commit is a good idea for the business or a bad idea, then we would deploy every commit individually to production, one at a time. Now, no such system exists in my, to my awareness, so every real deployment system is a compromise, you know, against that ideal based on what, you know, what's possible for your particular software development team. And so what we would do at IMVU was we would simply do, you know, we would do the deployment as soon as it was available. So you would commit as an engineer. You'd, you know, we had a central deployment server where you would, you know, trigger a deployment to happen. If there was already a deployment in progress, you had to wait until that deployment finished. And the finished, you know, the deployment takes about 20 minutes because we need time to run all the unit tests, we need time to do the incremental deployment and have the cluster immune system check it out, you know, deploying it to some machines and not others, making sure that, you know, no catastrophic problems happen. So there's kind of data-based stuff that takes time, real time. And during that time, other people might check in too. So in 20 minutes, you might have three check-ins. And then at the end of that, you know, you generally have a decision. Do you want to deploy only one of those three commits or all three together? And at that point, you're pretty much in a lose-lose situation. If you do them one at a time, you're intentionally delaying feedback for the third commit person, right? Because now they're not going to get their feedback for an hour. But if you do them all together in a batch size of three commits, then you risk that there's either some kind of interaction effect between the commits, or more importantly, if something goes wrong, you don't know exactly where to pinpoint the blame. So that's the theoretical answer. The good news is when you work in continuous deployment, commits tend to be really small. Giant commits, you know, are working in too large of a batch size. So is there really a significant difference between a 10 and a 30 line deployment where it's three 10 line commits? Like, actually in practice, it's not that big a deal. So that's, you know, that's how I believe in doing it. You basically run the deployment process as fast as you can. Try to keep the time of an individual deployment as low as possible, and then, you know, allow things to get batched up a little bit. If for whatever reason we had a automatic rollback where the commit system, you know, locks people out, and so, you know, forces people to, like the Toyota Prep system and Encore, right? We bring the line to a halt, get to the root cause of what happened, bring it back up. It's possible to get yourself in a situation where now there's a lot of work backed up that, like, is waiting to go out. And that's when you have to actually be a little bit more explicit and say, well, we're simply not willing to deploy 500 commits together. That's too large a batch. We will, in fact, make the choice to stage them out to, you know, just make sure that we're working in smaller batches. But the purpose of 5Ys and all this process stuff that I, you know, write about on my blog, the goal of all that stuff is to make it so that you don't get yourself in that situation in the first place, right? We try to get people to stop working if they can't be deployed, not generate more work in progress code, because you're going to wind up having to go rework that stuff later.
Okay, so Matt underscore S asks a long question, which I will paraphrase. It seems that a lot of lean startup stuff came out of, you know, lean software development and Scrum agile techniques. And he wonders, if you're already in a startup that's doing Scrum and, you know, does agile programming and whatnot, what is sort of the difference to changing over to lean startup? Is there any difference, that kind of thing?
There's a very significant difference. It's not to say that lean startup obsoletes agile or Scrum, but those processes were developed in a very specific context. Every single one of those methodologies was developed inside of big companies. And they were designed to solve a specific class of problems, which I characterize as known problem, unknown solution. Right? You know, if you're building a giant new accounting system for a big company, you know, to do payroll or something, there's already a very clear spec for what the payroll system is supposed to do. It's what the old payroll system does. You're replacing it with some new system. It should basically work like the old one, but, you know, somewhat better. You don't have to ask yourself, who's the customer for payroll? Why do we even want payroll? Everyone knows why you want payroll, right? If you don't have payroll, your company's going out of business pretty soon. So that's great. I mean, for that context, it's a very important, you know, those methodologies represent a quantum leap over traditional waterfall development. However, startups don't live in that world. We live in the world of the unknown problem, unknown solution, which is we don't even know what problem we're trying to solve. And that can lead to some very counterintuitive situations. Maybe let me try to illustrate with a story. It says in the Agile Manifesto, I mean, literally, you look at 12 principles of Agile. One of them is the unit of progress is working code or something like that. Right? That's how we judge whether we're making progress or not. And that's a pretty key insight, because compared to, you know, writing documents and specifications and, you know, waterfall type stuff, working code is really important. And also, a buggy code is not progress, because if you write buggy code, you're gonna have to go back and rework it later. So it's a kind of waste, right? I told this story before, so I'll try to be brief with it. When we built the first version of IMVU, we built it as an instant messaging add-on product. And for a variety of reasons, which we don't have to get into unless you're interested, customers did not like that. They wanted a standalone IM network. And it took us a while to come to that realization. As the guy who wrote the code to do IAM interoperability, I wasn't particularly open-minded about that fact. I had to basically be dragged to that realization. But we had the data. You know, we were practicing some elements of late startup already in the early days, and so we were looking at customers. They just wouldn't use it. It was a deal breaker. Okay. I had written tens of thousands of lines of code to do the IAM interoperability personally. Okay, so I want you to think about how depressed I was when we had to throw that code out. Because I was an Agile practitioner, I was really into extreme programming at that time, and I really believed that Agile would help us to have a waste-free product development scenario. And yet, I had to throw out all this code, because of course the biggest form of waste in startups is building something that nobody wants, which I had just done in spades, so I was pretty upset. And I was upset for this reason. I said, wait, are you telling me that if I had spent the last 6 months on vacation, I would have contributed just as much value to this company as I did cranking out all this code that had to get thrown away? And at first that was depressing. I said, oh, I guess, yeah, I should have been on vacation. This was a waste of time. But then I felt better. So I said, wait, no, that's not true. If we hadn't written all that code and shipped this product to the IMAT, we never would have learned this important fact about what customers want. And that was really a key insight that allowed us to be successful later. So I was like, oh, the learning we did, you know, redeems my energy and all that time. I said, oh, okay, I feel better. But then I had this kind of like really sneaky thought that snuck up on me, and then I was depressed again, which was, if my goal for the last 6 months was to learn this important fact about customers, did I really need 40,000 lines of code to do it? Is there no way I could have learned the same amount with 20,000 lines of code? Right? Did I need to support 8 IAM networks? Or could I have supported 4? Or 2? Or just 1? Right? Because remember, I had a product that 0% customers were willing to use. So, and then I had this, then I had the worst thought of all, which was, since I couldn't even get them to download the product, did I need to do any networks? Could I have learned the exact same amount by putting up a landing page, asking people to download this thing, and then talking to customers about why they wouldn't do it? And, you know, it's a judgment call, which of those activities would have been the optimal amount of learning per unit time. But I realized that practicing straight traditional Agile, I had been using the wrong unit of progress to measure my goal. I had been paying attention to how many working lines of code, you know, per day did I write. And it killed me. I had to throw away not just the good code, but also the bad code, right? Some of the IAM networks, I did a really good job unit testing and making sure that we did the interoperability perfectly. And kind of some of the other networks, I'd cut some corners and didn't do as good a job. It didn't matter. All got thrown away. And that was really freaky, right? That, you know, eventually I came to the realization that there are times when shipping a buggy product is in fact superior to shipping a non-buggy product, because you get the learning faster. And that just requires, you know, reevaluating all of these Agile practices to say, are they actually optimizing for this unit of progress we call validated learning? That is, are they really geared towards the learning context that startups require? So, you know, that's why, you know, I really believe that's why most Agile teams practice continuous integration but not continuous deployment. It's not like continuous deployment is so radically difficult that no one in the history of the world could have imagined it. It's just, it really only makes sense. You don't get the massive payoff unless you're in a situation of uncertainty where the speed of learning matters. You know, whereas in most traditional Agile contexts, not in startups, you know, in larger, more established organizations, or I should say with more established products, you know, a monthly or, you know, even quarterly release cycle, it basically makes sense. It's efficient. You know, it keeps people well utilized. It's kind of, it's safe. I understand why people do it. It's not the craziest thing in the world. But for a startup, I think it's just lethal.
Similar question asked by Patrick with two K's, related to other methodologies. How much percentage-wise or how similar is Lean Startup with the customer development methodology? And how does it diverge? What are the differences between it?
So for those that don't know, customer development is a term that was coined by a guy named Steve Blank. Now, Steve and I have been collaborators now for quite some time. He has been an investor in several of the companies I've worked in, and he was on the board at IMBU. And as a condition of my co-founder and I take raising money from him for IMBU, he required that we come audit his business school class that he was teaching at Berkeley Haas, you know, I think for the first year. And we would go trek down there and kind of hear him lecture about this new thing. He had coined this idea of customer development. And when I talk about problem team, solution team, the specific activities that the problem team should be doing, that's customer development. That's the, you know, a systematic methodology for figuring out what problem are we trying to solve, who's the customer, and, you know, all of the elements of the business plan, how do we validate each of them. And just in case anybody out there is in a startup but has for some bizarre reason not yet read Steve's book, The Four Steps to the Epiphany, you know, you can stop listening to this interview right now, go out and get a copy, and, you know, yeah. I see you've got a copy right there. Yeah, I mean, it's a cult classic. Okay, you know, it's Steve. He has self-published it. It is just action-packed. It's full of useful information, and it is for early adopters of, you know, entrepreneurs. This is not a mainstream business book by any stretch, but I think that was what makes it like 10 times better than your average business book. So that's customer development. When I tried to combine what I had learned about product development. Steve comes from a marketing background. I come from a product development background. So we kind of come at the same problem from two different angles. And I wanted to make sure that I differentiated what I'm talking about from what he's talking about, because A, there are areas where we disagree, but more like, you know, more importantly, just we each want to be able to say our own thing and have it be separate. And then that way we can compare the differences. And I think that's good for the ecosystem. For us to start to create terms that have specific meanings, because that becomes then a shorthand way of having a more interesting conversation. So what I use a lean startup to mean is this combined entity, right? The whole company taking customer development and the principles of agile development and kind of fusing them together into a company-wide feedback loop of learning and discovery. So that's, you know, that's just what the terms mean. The details, you know, we have our disagreements. Steve comes from a, you know, enterprise software background and from kind of an earlier era of the high-tech business. And, you know, my experiences are more recent. So I think, you know, I've been working in consumer internet. And so we have kind of slightly different orientations to that too. But, you know, I would say that the ideas are very complementary.
Okay. Prakash asks, what best practices would you recommend if you need to do customer development and discovery over the phone?
Well, over the phone is a big step up from surveys and email. So, like, I often hear people say, yeah, I do customer development. I answer the customer service inquiries for my company. It's like, I see, you listen by email to the loudest complainers. Congratulations. But that's not customer development, okay? Customer development is actually, what Steve says, getting out of the building, okay? When you're in your office and you're, you know, thinking hard, grandiose thoughts about your product, or when you're coding, you are engaged in an internal interior process. You're not really confronting reality. And so get out of the building means take your brain and train it on real customer information. Over the phone, I think, is almost as good as in person. So both of those have the advantage that you use all that brain hardware we all have that's good for mind reading, right? That's like looking at tone of voice, facial expression, you know, the way in which people say things. Because what you want to get, there's something very specific you're looking for in the first step of customer development called customer discovery, where you're actually trying to qualify, is this person I'm talking to an early adopter for my product or not? That's the big question. Because remember, if there are no early adopters at all for your product, you're in trouble. When you're talking to an early adopter about possibly solving a really important problem to them, they will generally not let you leave the room without letting you buy the thing. Without letting them buy the thing, excuse me. So, like, they're literally like, I need this right now. It's cruel and unusual for you to come in here, tease me, tell me that such a solution could exist, and then walk out and, you know, like, you're just like, that's no way, right? You know, and whatever you who are listening, whatever you're an early adopter of, right, try to imagine that the CEO of the company that makes the thing that you think is most cool, like, drops by your house and it says, hey, I've got this, you know, I'm thinking about building this really cool product. I have a prototype in my car, but I want to come get your feedback on it. Okay, thanks, I have to go now. You're like, but I want to go out to the car. I want to see it, right? You can't let me not see it. And then, you know, I got to have my iPad. Like, please, you know, can I please buy one from you right now, right? That's the response you're looking for. It's very hard to judge that in a survey. It's pretty easy to judge it over the phone, right? How do you feel about me solving this problem for you? Okay. You know, yeah, I'd buy that, sure. Okay, that's not an early adopter, right? You can tell from the tone of voice. They're not that into it. They think it's okay. They think it's fine. Most people will tell you that they'll buy pretty much anything because they want to please you. You're on the phone with them. They don't want to be rude. That's not good enough. So the specific technique, I mean, just call them. You know, get into the regular discipline of having, say, 3 customer conversations a week, 20 minutes each, 1 hour a week. For most, like, engineering-type founders, who are, you know, just cranking out code all the time, just an hour a week will rock your world. That's my prediction. So, you know, it doesn't need to be a full-time job at first.
Okay, another very specific question from Rob DeMarco, which I thought was a good one. He's in a startup where he wants to make data-driven decisions like the methodology advocates, but there is a lot of limited and incomplete data in the sense that there's very few customers, because it's a high sales item, and so the actual transactions are minimal. So they're trying to do split testing and stuff, but they're having trouble figuring out what to do with such limited data.
That is a difficult situation for techniques like split testing, and I would say, okay, don't do split testing. That's okay. There are advantages to having a very small number of customers, and the key is to use those advantages when you're in this situation. If you happen to be doing something like enterprise software where the selling price is going to be huge and therefore the sales cycles are long, you really do want to read Steve's book. I mean, this is what Steve made his money doing, is these kinds of sales. He's really has a lot of very practical tips on exactly how to get this information. The general, you know, I could just give you the gist of it.
Just to be clear, his actually isn't that, just because I know him, is
let me understand.
It is consumer-based. Well, I'll just even tell you what it is. They're buying travel bookings over the internet last minute, and so they're just sort of expensive places to go, and so there's not a lot of customers right now.
There's not a lot of customers right now. Well, that's a whole different thing, right? There's a difference between small available market in terms of number of customers. You know, when you're selling to, like, you know, armies, you know, if you want to sell them a high tech weapons product, there just aren't that many possible customers in the whole world, and you need to, you know, handle that in a specific way. Oh, this is a different situation. I see. I didn't understand. When you have a pathetically small number of customers, that's great. That's wonderful. Forget split testing. Again, you need split testing because you have large sample sizes and you need to, like, aggregate tons of data because you have too many customers. When you have small numbers of customers, you can get to know each of them really, really well, right? If you can actually have a conversation with every person who purchases your product, or better yet, every person who thinks about purchasing but doesn't, if you're still at that small size, then the level of, remember, think about what we're trying to do. We're trying to learn what customers really care about and not. You can learn way more in that kind of situation than you can when you're trying to deal with all this volume. We use analytics and data warehousing and split testing to manage when there's too much data, to approximate, right, to get summaries. You don't need that yet. So instead of asking, why do I have such a small number of customers and how can I get more? I'd turn it around. I'd say, why is it that anybody's using your product? What is wrong with those people? 99.99% of the world's population does not use your product, yet these people do. What do they have in common? Right? What's their mental defect that makes them want to use it? You know, it probably, if I had to guess, will look a lot like the same mental defect that led you to create the company in the first place. Is you're probably dealing with visionary customers who share the vision of what you're trying to do. And so invite them into your development process. Invite them to become co-creators of what you're doing. I think that could be really fun.
So in your view, does this methodology apply basically to every kind of startup? Is there ones where it works better than others, like, for instance, not software, like a biotech company or something?
Yeah, well, I do believe the principles are broad. Tactics are specific, right? So continuous deployment obviously makes no sense in a business where there's no physical product, right? If it's a strictly person-to-person service business, like, what are you continuously deploying? Well, maybe, you know, continuously deploying new procedures that you try to train people on, but humans are not computers, they can't learn them. So it's like, you know, when you try to translate practices, you get in trouble. So just don't worry about that. Understand the principles and figure out how the principles apply. However, there is a continuum of the type of risk that you're taking when you undertake a new startup, right? What we call the technology risk businesses are the ones where the key question to ask is it even possible to build this thing? Right? If I pitch you cure for cancer as a business, no one has to ask, does anybody want cure for cancer? Is there a market for cure for cancer? Yes, the market is extremely well understood. It's extremely lucrative. It is a very clear size. And the big question is, do you actually have the technology to cure cancer? If so, like, please stop talking to me. Go work on that right now. Right? That's, you know, that's technology risk. And market risk is simply not can it be built, but should it be built? If I come to you and I can't tell you the last software-based product that someone pitched me where I really had to think, is it possible to do what they're saying? Right? I mean, you know, we're going to build a new vertical social network for people who love X. Okay. Is that possible? Yeah, it's possible. Right? Of course it's possible. Is it worth people's time and energy to invest? Well, I don't know. That depends. Well, it depends on what? Depends on all those things we've been talking about. Are there customers? Will the customers buy? Blah, blah, blah. And then there's a ton of businesses in the middle that have both technical risk and also customer risk, right? And a lot of bioscience falls into that category where, you know, like, obviously if you have a cure for cancer, that's one thing, but, you know, take a company like Fitbit, who's working on a device that helps you, you know, make decisions about your physical health, right? So it's kind of like a real-time monitor for your body. Well, there's a bunch of new technical challenges to actually build a new physical device to make sure it measures, and, you know, you can easily imagine that they basically realize, oops, we just cannot build the right form factor for this product. It's too, the data, the technology is not yet there, the sensors aren't good enough. But okay, now that they actually have a little device, you know, they sent me one. That's why I was picking them as an example. I'm a fan of the company, but it took me, like, you know, one day to lose the device. So I never got any data out of it because, like, it's somewhere, but, you know, it's really hard to, you know, I had to change my behavior to keep track and dock it at the station. I mean, it's a whole set of behaviors that I had to learn to actually get the Fitbit to work. So that's a company that had to take both kinds of risk. The reason that spectrum is important is the further you are on the market risk side of the spectrum, the more value I think you'll get out of lean startup and customer development techniques. If you're 100% completely pure technical risk, then these, you know, techniques can still help you a little bit, but it's going to be marginal. The problem is most people think they're further on the technical risk side of the spectrum than they really are. So even if you think that's where you are, lean startup and in particular customer development can help you realize, oops, I didn't get myself right on the spectrum. So it's still worth taking a look.
A couple more questions. What is the difference between a minimum viable product, an MVP, and a proof of concept, if anything? This was asked by Tall Todd. Just want to get that in there.
Oh, yeah. Thank you, Tall Todd. I appreciate the question. So proof of concept is a kind of a vague term to me. I may not mean it in the same sense as somebody else is meaning it. So when I talk about specific words having specific meanings, the reason I use the phrase minimum viable product is I'm trying to get that phrase to mean something very specific. What it means is that version of a product which requires the least work in order to get that initial learning from early adopters. Okay, so that's, I try to be very specific about what it is. My feeling about what the phrase proof of concept means is simply some kind of prototype. MVP tends not to be a prototype in the sense of, like, just a mock-up that's non-functional. And it's rare for a company, it was a startup, to build an MVP and then throw it away and then build the real product. You often hear people claim that that's going to be their plan, but it rarely works out in practice. Usually your, you know, so-called prototype actually just is version one, and then you start iterating on that. Because we're software people, we never like to call that version 1.0. So most of the software companies I work with are, like, 3, 4, 5 years in, still waiting to get to version 1.0. It's like, no. Version 1.0 should be, just give that up, okay? Just number the versions, okay? Version one, the first one you show to customers, that's version one, and then we iterate from there. Another way to think about it is, which concept is being proved by the proof of concept? The other association I have with that term is that it's a very technical thing that shows, yes, it is possible to build a device kind of like this, rather than measuring how customers respond to that device and does it actually solve a problem for them? So that's how I think about the two terms.
Olibud asked, what companies since IMVU would you consider to be lean startups, and why haven't we heard more breakout stories of companies using the methodology? I mean, I assume that's just because it's so early, and I assume lots of people use it and they don't know that they're calling it lean startups.
Well, so this is a really dangerous, we're in a very dangerous moment in the lean startup movement, which is nothing specific to lean startup. Every movement, every business idea always has this issue. The question is, all right, you've gotten enough attention that people are like, oh yeah, there's this thing called lean startup. And they have to be like, well, what are the case studies and what are the successful companies? And the temptation is always to posthumously convert companies from the past into your methodology to claim that, you know, as soon as I announced it, already Google is using it, and already, you know, well, Microsoft really was a lean startup, they just didn't know it, or whatever, Twitter or Facebook, whoever the fad company of the day is, yes, they really use my principles. You read a lot of business books, you can see that that's going on, right? These examples are being shoehorned into the model in order to illustrate the point and kind of gain credibility. And I just, like, to me, that's success theater. That's claiming a level of success that the model doesn't deserve, and I don't want to do that. So you got to remember, I coined the term lean startup like 18 months ago, and I first started speaking about it in public not more than 1 year ago, April 1st last year, okay, at the Web 2.0 Expo in San Francisco was my first big talk. So it's really new, okay? There's not academic research on this. There's not solid evidence that this in fact works. What keeps me going, the reason I'm still inspired to work on this, is lots of entrepreneurs have read my work, you know, and given me feedback, have come to Lean Startup meetups, have come to workshops, conferences, talks, you know, asked me to travel to them. There's a lot of people who have been engaged in the movement who seem to be getting value out of it. And I try to judge the success of what I'm doing based on how does it impact the lives of practicing entrepreneurs. And some of those companies are starting to get some visibility. So, you know, I get to now drop some names. Like, if you think about we're doing the Startup Lessons Learned conference next week, April 23rd in San Francisco, you know, we're actually able to present case studies at that conference. KissMetrics, Grokket, Aardvark, who was bought by Google, PB Works, who else is presenting? And of course, like, the contemporary IMVU. So, you know, I'm always talking about what we did 6 years ago now. We founded IMVU in those first, you know, early months. But, okay, now it's a 75-person company. It's highly profitable. Are they still doing lean startup type stuff? People want to know. Well, they'll come and they'll actually be able to talk about it. So the problem, you know, but there's hazards, right? All of those companies have adopted some aspect of the model or found some aspect of my work helpful. Does that make them official lean startups? If they all go IPO, does that mean the model works? If they all fail, does it mean the model doesn't work? The lean startup, all it can do is increase your probability of success. Can't guarantee success. So I really don't think these questions about, like, well, what famous or successful person is using this is actually very helpful. The better question is, what are some experiments I could run in my own life to try to test if these ideas actually have the consequences that are predicted? And that's why I try to be so specific about what I recommend, why I recommend it, and what's supposed to happen if it's right, so that you can try it yourself in small bits. You don't have to say, I will adopt the whole model, whole, you know, hook, line, and sinker, but I'll say, no, I'm going to start with increasing the pace at which I do deployments, right? I can go from, heck, I could go from 1 month to 2 weeks, from 2 weeks to 1 week to, you know, to 1 day. You should see, and if you read my blog, I try to be specific as I can, you should see very concrete outcomes as a result of doing that. And if you do, then you can be like, all right, that gives me some validation that principle kind of makes sense. Now let's maybe try a little split testing. Maybe now let's try a little MVP, right? And eventually, my belief, if your journey is anything like mine, you will wind up in a place where you'll use all this stuff because I think the pieces fit together in a coherent way. But you got to judge that for yourself. It doesn't matter if famous person X uses it or not. That's my opinion.
So when I look at this, your big graph, your main slide lists all the techniques you use, and the idea generation part, am I missing something? Like, why isn't, like, brainstorming and creativity of coming up with these tests after talking to customers a bigger part of this?
I guess it's very important. It's just most of the startups that I work with just don't have an ideas problem. They don't lack for vision. I mean, maybe that's just because I'm spoiled and I live in Silicon Valley and I meet, like, truly visionary entrepreneurs, like, on a daily basis who really inspire me. But even, like, big companies, like, I have a consulting practice, I work with big companies, And when they bring me in, oftentimes when they've hired an innovation expert to help them do disruptive innovation, they spend a lot of time working on brainstorming and coming up with crazy new ideas. So even like the most boring big companies do not lack for cool new ideas. I mean, people generally are drowning in good ideas. The question is, how do we filter the good ones from the bad ones? How do we deal with all the noise of combining our ideas with customer, you know, feedback? So there is a lot. I mean, fundamentally, customer development is a generative process, and things like split testing are more validation techniques, and the two go hand in hand, right? Split testing can tell you that something doesn't work, or that it does work, but it can't tell you why. To do the why, you still have to do the human-centered design. You still have to get the person in the room and talk to them. You still have to do the usability testing. Like, Lean Startup doesn't obsolete any of that stuff. You still got to build a great product, and in order to do that, customers are going to have to be involved in that development process. But in addition, there's kind of, you know, extra work you have to do. The only good news I can offer is the goal of Lean Startup is not for you to do more work. It's actually for you to do less work. So once you start doing, say, split testing and discovering that 60% of your features make no difference to customers, you can stop building those features, right? And so you can save 60% of your time if you can actually start to get good at anticipating what customers will and won't want.
Okay, a final, more personal question by a marketer. If basically, why did you leave IMVU if it was so successful and you were having
If it's such a successful company, why are you doing this and not that? I also like the related question. Well, if you are so smart about startups, why aren't you out there making a lot of money on your own startup? Why are you sharing these so-called?
I've seen that one too many times. I've deleted that one. But it's an interesting question, this one, because it's sort of like the Lean Startup stuff is fun, and you were in the middle of it, and you had all these great processes. Yeah. Why leave when it's so much fun, you know?
Yeah, well, of course, it sounds fun in retrospect. Look, dude, startup is really wicked hard, okay? I mean, someone asked me a question recently, like, why did you leave IMBU so early? I was like, I was there for almost 5 years of my life. That is a long time by any standard, okay? And in the modern work world, like, working at the same job for 5 years, that's a significant thing, I think. And I think a lot of people believe, you know, if you're not CEO of your own company and get to do it, you know, for your whole life, you're a failure. And I just think that's dumb. There are people who are in the right place at the right time, in the right place in their career, and have the right company to do that. But as a founder, you have a special responsibility, I think, to always be asking yourself the question, is what I want to do personally aligned with what the company needs me to do for it to be successful? And the moment you detect any misalignment in those two things, you have to be proactive. Well, I think you have an obligation to be proactive about addressing it. I have seen way too many founders cling to their company way too long. I've seen massive dysfunction caused by founder conflict, about founders leaving too soon or refusing to leave. When I founded IMV, one of my promises I made to myself is I won't be that guy. I will not be a founder that has to get kicked out because of one of these, you know, alignment problems. And I'll be proactive about asking myself that question. And it got to the point where I had the realization that what I wanted to do from a career point of view and what the company needed me to do really weren't that well aligned anymore. And it wasn't a bad thing. You know, it wasn't that the company done something wrong. It wasn't that I'd done something wrong. It was that the job the company needed me to do was not a job I wanted to do. And so I thought, all right, now's the time to proactively try to manage around that. And we, you know, I'm very proud actually of we did a very extended transition. You know, to me, the kind of the acid test of my skill as a manager was, can I build a self-sustaining organization that can adjust and learn and develop without me, right? Because I could, you know, never know, I could be hit by a bus anytime. So actually what I'm most proud of, you know, personally about IMBU is how well they've done since I left. I mean, I think that's fantastic. I think that they've done well, you know, not just business success, but from a management and kind of internal organization point of view, I think they're actually working faster than they were, you know, now that they're a 75% company than they were when we were a 25% company. That's, you know, I'm proud of that. So that's why.
So we've hit a lot of things. Is there anything else that I totally missed that you want to say to people about getting traction?
Well, the last thing I'll say is, why do you want traction? Right? We get really caught up in the ego of, I want to be a success, I want to make money, I want to do all this stuff. And I really encourage people to just from time to time take a step back and ask yourself, why am I doing this in the first place? it's my fundamental belief that if all you're trying to do is make money or, quote, be successful, entrepreneurship is not a very good path. It's really quite a pain, okay? It's really extremely difficult. It's trying. It's draining, and it's very uncertain. But if you have an ambition to change the world and also create something of lasting value at the same time, I think entrepreneurship uniquely allows you to do that combination. And so when we talk about getting traction, you know, we sometimes get confused. We're not talking about dots on a spreadsheet. We're talking about actually individual people making a choice of their own free will to be involved with your company and your product for a reason. And so I say that because we often say, well, how do we reconcile the difference between vision and data, right? I have this brilliant vision and it's all about me, and yet this data comes in and it's not what I expected, and should I just abandon my vision? And that is a very ego, individual kind of perspective, which I think is actually quite harmful. The vision should be of changing the world in a better way. Data then can be in service of executing that vision, right? Because of the vision, if it's really important to make it happen, and I really felt this way at IMVU, we wanted to create a new form of human communication that would really be really helpful to a set of people who in their regular lives were somewhat isolated. We thought we could give them a new sense of intimacy and community online that they didn't have. That's too important a vision to take faith-based swings at, right? We needed, you know, not just because we wanted to make money, but because we really wanted that thing to happen. We needed to be really rigorous about making sure that we hadn't made some stupid fatal mistake along the way while still remaining true to that end vision. So that's my closing thought.
Well, thank you very much for doing the interview.
Hey, thank you very much. This is a lot of fun. Appreciate it.
All right.